asylum seekers in this country. The Home Secretary, Priti Patel, is announcing today a two-tier asylum plan that she and her department have come up with to try and deter channel crossings and favour refugees. She's not favouring refugees. The channel crossing seems to favour refugees who arrive in Britain illegally, and she wants to help those who come through a normal route and get here legally. Delighted to introduce onto the show Mr. Henry Bolton, advisor on strategic border management and, of course, former prominent politician in this country as UKIP leader. And I'm delighted to say Henry's on the line now. Henry, thank you very much indeed for joining me.
Good afternoon, Mike.
Thank you very much indeed. Priti Patel is going to unveil a plan today, which she says she hopes will go some way to trying to stop the flood of people perilously coming across the English Channel, who she would say have no right to be here. What do you think of what you've seen of a plan so far?
Well, not very much, to be honest, Mike. So much of what's come out of this government, and indeed the previous government, and Theresa May when she was Prime Minister and Home Secretary as well before this lot, was full of sound and fury, but actually didn't signify very much. Lots of intent, lots of wish list. This is what I want to achieve. This is what I want to happen, but very light on the detail as to how it's going to happen. Mm. And the reality is that the Home Office is floundering really more than a leaking migrant dinghy. They really have very little clue. They're scrabbling around looking for ideas and actually lack within the civil service in the Home Office the relevant expertise, knowledge and experience to come up with the right solutions. And they're all already very much demonstrating that they are still thinking in the mindset of something called the Dublin III Agreement, which is the EU's framework for dealing with this thing. There's a fundamental problem here in that most countries, for example, Canada and the US, have entirely robust systems for turning away people who maybe started off as refugees, but then once they'd fled the persecution and the risk to life and so on, mm-hmm. where they were originally, for example, Syria, yep. if they'd fled there. But then had later been motivated by looking for economic benefit, mm-hmm. which one understands. Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, if you're looking for a better job, a better income, better education, healthcare, whatever, you become an economic migrant. Yeah. And then you need to have the correct paperwork and move to a country lawfully. Mm-hmm. And if you don't, then that country has the right under international protocols to deny entry. Yeah. The problem we've got is that the Home Office is still framed itself in its thinking in the EU context.
Right, okay. Well, thanks for outlining that. Now, let me just put it to you that actually the Home Secretary has come up with a series of initiatives during the last sort of 3 or 4 days in the run-up to the Tory party conference. She's talking about perhaps creating colonies to where mm-hmm. Asylum seekers can be taken and can then be, you know, sorted, can be prepared for what life is really like. If you try to get into this country, you don't stay here, you go elsewhere, even as far away as St. Helena. I've heard of the Australian system of a few years ago when they were besieged by asylum seekers. They did exactly the same. They took people to Papua New Guinea and that worked. And according to a former Australian foreign secretary, they killed the trade off because the people smugglers then found they didn't have any clients. I mean, I think she is actually showing some initiative, isn't she? And you haven't seemed to be giving her any credit for it.
Well, there's a lot of thinking going on, but it's not terribly practical. I mean, the Australian situation is very different to ours. They're not dealing with a bloc such as the EU that has very strict principles and mm-hmm. laws relating to the movement within the bloc and its external borders. Australia did have the means to and the opportunity to use islands and countries outside its own sort of, if you like, mainland, yep. which we don't have. If we had a small island in the middle of the channel off Dover, mm. then I would say this may be a workable solution.
Ellis Island, yes.
Yeah, well, that's an option here. Yeah. I mean, somebody suggested Rockall the other day, but I'm not sure that they'd fit on there.
But the
point is that we're not in the same scenario as Australia. I'm not saying we can't learn from Australia, but we are in our own environment here in terms of migration mm-hmm. and in dealing with the European Union and in the Brexit context. So we've got to take that into account. We can't stop. A lot of people advocate, and frankly, it would be ideal, and I would love to be able to do it, turning these people back mid-channel. Mm-hmm. But it is the busiest waterway in the world, and
people say that, Henry, honestly, and I think they're just using that as an excuse. I have not yet seen any pictures of dinghies floating around in the middle of the channel, which every news organisation is now getting out there and taking because it's good footage and all that. I haven't seen one oil tanker or one ship in the background. And I'm beginning to wonder whether it's the busiest shipping channel in the world. It's just a load of nonsense.
Well, it is the busiest shipping lane in the world. There's no denying that, just because you don't see the oil tankers in the background. I mean, I live down on the Kent coast.
Yep.
If anybody looks out there at any point in the day and the night, you will see these vast ships traveling backwards and forwards in both directions, east and west. It is the busiest shipping lane in the world, and that does make it a little bit more dangerous. Mm. The fact is, though, that there are various international laws that prevent any nation, the French or the British, potentially creating a danger to life.
Oh, I totally agree. This idea of bringing out water pumps and creating waves, I mean, what would happen there? Tip over a dinghy and people drown. You know, it's ridiculous.
I'd have no problem if I was the Home Secretary with somebody coming up with that idea. I'd consider it for about 2 seconds and they'd say, no, that's not really workable now, is it?
Exactly.
So, you know, come up with the ideas, folks, but let's not discuss them seriously, because a lot of them. What we need to do is we need to recognise that, unfortunately, however much we would like to, we can't turn them back in the middle of the channel.
So we've got to stop them leaving the continent, haven't we?
Well, that's one option, and the Home Office is working with the French on that, and I'll give them credit for that. But the French have no law that these people are legally in the European Union. Mm. And so the French have no law that enables them to prevent these people getting on a dinghy and leaving the French coast.
Yeah.
Likewise, international law prevents them, if they don't want to return, from returning them back to the French coast by force.
Yeah. Okay.
So it's down to our borders.
Okay. I want to give a bit of praise to Priti Patel. First of all, let's just outline what she's going to talk about today. She plans to bring in a two-tier system that will create a legal assumption that people who use illegal routes to come to Britain will not be granted asylum, while those who use new routes designed to identify the most vulnerable will find it easier. Surely, if that message gets out, don't bother getting in your dinghy and sailing over to Britain, you will be nabbed on the other side and you will never become a citizen of the United Kingdom. That's an initiative, isn't it?
But you've got to have, again, it's about the implementation. And the Home Office, I've been speaking to very senior people, very close to the Home Secretary in the Home Office, and they really are a bit clueless. They don't know how to implement this. These are ideals, fine, but they're not listening to anybody outside the civil service as to how to implement them. And the civil service, with its rotation of 2 to 3 years in a post, doesn't allow people to accrue the experience to deal with it, to understand how.
So what would you do? What would you do, Henry, if you could help them out? Because you're an advisor on this matter, advisor on strategic border management. What would be your solution?
Yeah, well, I've helped 14 countries to develop strategies to deal with this sort of thing. The answer is that we have to accept that, unfortunately, we have to bring them into Dover. But, you know, if somebody arrives at Gatwick or Heathrow Airport with the right paperwork, what do we do? We don't welcome them in and then put them into a detention centre and process them and so on. What we do is we say, hang on a minute, you haven't got the right paperwork, you're getting on the next flight back. Mm-hmm. We can't do that because of the European Union system, which we leave at the end of this year.
Yes.
At that point, we need to be ready to be able to take them into Dover and process them in the same way.
Yes.
We hold them in a holding facility at Dover.
Mm.
We bring them in there safely. At that point, we give them a quick medical check, welfare check, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
We feed them. We make sure they're not suffering from anything, from COVID or whatever it might be.
Yep.
And what we do is then we send them back from there. Mm-hmm. So we process, and we can also filter. There are some people. There's probably around 20% that have some sort of legitimate claim to come to the UK.
Right.
And we need to filter them out and separate all of the others that should or could have applied for asylum
this
elsewhere.
This is a huge process, isn't it? A huge process. It's red tape. It's employing people for billions of pounds. You know, I mean, it's a very difficult problem. What about this, Henry?
Mike, it's not that expensive.
Well,
it's not that expensive.
Well,
it's much lighter than what we do now.
Yeah, well,
it could be done in 2 or 3 days. and they could be returned then to France on a regular scheduled trip back.
But then people would legally challenge it all the time. I mean, we
they wouldn't,
read
because
read
they wouldn't be in the UK.
We okay, yeah, I accept that. We read of an aeroplane, didn't we, last week? A full an aeroplane with something like 30 seats on it took one person back, you know, and that was because of legal challenges. What about a solution I put up, Henry? I want you to consider this, please, because I've said this before. If the people come, could we give them an initial grant of £5,000 and say, you are going to Northumberland or Cumbria because we are going to start building new towns in this country, just like we built new towns after the Second World War in anticipation of the baby boom that would follow the end of the Second World War. If people want to come to this country, think of Jamestown in America when that started, OK? Give them a stake in the community they're going to live in. Give them an incentive to make the circumstances in which they live better for themselves, for their families. And, you know, I mean, we have to accept a lot of people who come here want to come here to gain a better standard of living, but are prepared to contribute to that and to work hard, aren't they?
I mean, there are a number of problems with that, Mike. I mean, I get the goodwill behind that.
Yep.
But when you consider that the continent of Africa, the population there is going to double to about 4.2 billion by the end of this century.
Yes.
Africa's governance in the countries in Africa, their economies, their work, the prejudice, the conflict, the drought, the lack of agriculture and so on, is already putting pressure on the populations of Africa to move. Mm. Where are those extra 2 billion people going to move to when they've already got established routes to Europe and the UK?
Yeah.
We've got to think ahead.
I understand that.
The other thing is that to that extent, it will destroy our environment and it put massive pressure on our infrastructure.
Yeah.
And talking Priti Patel, she's also, I understand, going to talk about policing this afternoon.
Yes.
Now, I mean, she's going to make a big thing about the Conservative Party recruiting another 20,000 police officers.
Mm-hmm.
But that masks the memory that in the last 10 years, the Conservatives have cut 31,000 support staff, closed over 600 police stations and the regional training colleges.
Mm. And what does this have to do with asylum seekers?
It doesn't directly, but what I'm saying is if you're going to bring more people into the country whilst you're cutting back on the services that are available to the population as a whole, then you're creating all sorts of other internal problems.
Yeah.
So, I mean, going back to that process that we talked about, they arrive at Dover at a holding facility. That initial screening could take 2 to 3 days maximum, and they could be returned.
But there isn't the facility or will to do that at the moment. She's got to get that in place. And I accept what you're saying is you know one possible solution, but possible solutions have been discarded by politicians without the will to do it for the last 30 years, and probably
now,
still
there
will.
There you hit the point, Mike.
Mm.
It's about political will.
Yeah.
And what Priti Patel is doing, and she does it remarkably well, but it's the wrong thing to do, is she is responding to media headlines.
Well, I think that's a bit unfair. She's got a job to do. I think she's diligent in the way she approaches it.
Well, that's generous of you.
Yeah.
But why? You know, the day that she went down to Dover, she ensured that Royal Air Force transport plane was flying up and down the channel.
Mm.
It's not a surveillance plane, it's a transport plane.
Yeah.
That was clearly for the aesthetics of it. It was for the cameras.
But
it was for the
Henry,
media.
That's politics, honestly. You know you know that better than I do. Crikey, you know, when Boris goes and poses in front of a JCB digger, it's all politics.
Of course it is.
And that's what they all do. Let me put one thing
it's
to you,
theater,
please, Henry.
But theatre should be combined with practical and realistic solutions.
Yeah. Let me put one thing to you, please, Henry, because you know so much about this. I once proposed that both David Cameron and Tony Blair should go in front of a Commons committee and explain why they individually managed to smash up Iraq and Libya, which has caused a massive outflow of the people of Libya and Iraq through North Africa, across the Mediterranean, through Europe and here. And neither of them made any preparations to stop that happening when they got into their gung-ho mood of wanting to be a conquering leader. Would you support that proposition?
I would, absolutely, Mike. And you probably don't know, but I led, bizarrely, the European Union's technical planning team assessing the situation in Libya in 2013 for an EU intervention to stabilise the place. Mm-hmm. That was an experience in itself because the EU is all about aesthetics again and no real solutions. But I spent some months there dealing with that, and I can tell you the fallout for that nation and the people in that nation from that intervention, which was badly planned, badly envisaged, badly thought through, has been a disaster.
Oh,
we look
disaster.
At it from afar and think it is, but I tell you, from within that country, it's an absolute disaster.
Oh, it's an absolute disaster.
I agree with you.
100%. I totally agree. I worked in Libya in the sort of early 80s. I was there at the time that the US Air Force bombed it, actually bombed the hotel I was in. And I have to say, although it was run by a dictator, Colonel Gaddafi, it was a very stable country, honestly. Everybody just, did what was required of them within the country. They weren't necessarily brutalised or anything like that. It was a stable country. Unfortunately, dictators exist in this world, and it's not a perfect world. Henry, thanks very much indeed for joining me today. That was Henry Bolton, advisor on strategic border management, talking about the situation regarding asylum seekers, which of course is being addressed as we speak by Priti Patel, the Home Secretary. It's a problem that has been insoluble over the last 30 years, but now it's coming to a head, of course, because sadly more and more people have been displaced over the last couple of decades. And can you really honestly blame anybody for wanting a better life? I know we always have this distinction between economic migrants and those who are really fleeing terror and torture and all that, but anybody in the right mind is going to say, there's a part of the world where life is much easier. Not easier, but I mean much more pleasant. You work hard, you get paid, and you enjoy a stable society in which to live. I don't blame anybody in the world who looks for that. And what we have to do is we have to manage it, because you can't make a rich country poor or a poor country rich by mixing the two up. You've got to have a stable society. If people want to come and they want to work hard and enjoy it, that's fine. But we've got to have a sifting system. Otherwise, the country will implode with overpopulation. Okay.